The imaginary island study is a series of lessons that help the children integrate their geography studies in a very constructive and creative way. And it has different stages. The first stage is the topographical stage. And this comes after work with the geographic feature card, so that the children are familiar with the names of the different coastal features. And you may even want to get those geographic feature cards out, the ones that refer to the coastal features, and talk about it. Then the children draw an island, and they first start labeling the exterior or the coastal features, and they shade the water around the outside of their island, and then they label those features. And they can do it generically like I did on this map, but typically children like to personalize it and give their features names. So, you know, they'll have Shark Bay or Captain's Cape or whatever, and you know, they can be encouraged to draw you know, a series of these until they get one they're really happy with. So when they find an island that they're happy with and they've named their island and named the features, then you can move on to talking about the interior features. And to do this, you'll want to build an island out of plasticine and put it in some kind of waterproof tray. And you know, this also gives the children kind of an aerial perspective of looking down on an island. And then you take a watering can with a sprinkling head, and you just sprinkle the water down over your island, and you point out to the children, you know, this is of course simulating rainfall, and the children see obviously how the water goes from the high land down into the sea, and that if there's any little depressions, those will form lakes. So then they can trace another outline of their island, and you can show them different ways to indicate mountains on their island. Then once they have their mountains, then they can start drawing rivers. And the idea is when they draw the rivers that they always are drawing them coming from the mountain to the coast, which means they'll have to rotate their drawing so they're always pulling the rivers down towards themselves. And you can show them, you know, a delta or tributaries, and you can even let them draw in little lakes and things. So now they have their island with the interior features and the exterior features. Then the next step is to determine the location of their island, the area, and the climate. So for this one, they trace their same island again, only this time on graph paper. And they decide what is their scale going to be. On mine, I have 1 square equals 1 square mile. And then they start counting first all the whole squares to determine area. And you want to have them put little dots so they don't lose track, and then kind of, you know, estimate how the partial squares add up. It doesn't have to be exact. And then they fill in. This is their area of their island. Then they need to look on the globe and find a location for their island, and they can't put it on top of another landmass, so they have to find a place that's open. And then so they draw in their line of latitude and their line of longitude, and they measure it, and they label it with the degrees. So mine's 135 degrees west by 30 degrees south of the equator. Have them add in a little compass rose. So with this study, you can bring in lessons on the cardinal points of the compass, lessons on latitude and longitude. And from here, once they have the latitude and longitude, they can start to determine what kind of climate their island has. And of course, since mine's only 30 degrees south of the equator, it's pretty warm there. But also, you're going to want to have the children look at maps of ocean currents and see, is there a cold current flowing by their island? Is there a warm current? And maps of the different winds blowing around the island, and determine what kind of climate their island has. Now, once they have all this information on their island, then they can go on to a more advanced island studies, imaginary island studies. And the next stage would be, they, once they know the climate, they can determine what kind of flora and fauna live there. And again, you'll want them to consult different atlases and references, vegetation maps of the world, to determine what kind of things truly grow and live in that, those latitudes where they've placed their island. They can check rainfall maps and see how moist it is, and help them also determine the kind of flora. It's just endless where they can go from here. They can then decide about the people that live on the island. Where did they come from? When did they first arrive at that island? Were there different waves of migration? Were there people who invaded their island? Then they can just create the whole history of their island with the people who colonized the island, what kind of society they have, their government. It just can go as far as the children's imagination and interest take them. And as you go through this, as you're going through the levels, if they lose interest in this island, you know, they can always start again with a new one. So this study, even probably with your youngest 6 to 9 children, you'd only do these 3 levels. It's just a winner. The children love it. It's integrative, it's constructionist, and I really encourage you to introduce this to your students.